Hello friends, good afternoon and welcome to EduSat Live Lectures. Dear friends, today in modern Indian history, we will be talking about the revolutionaries. To discuss this topic, we have with us our subject expert, Dr. Manoj Sharma. Dr. Sharma is Assistant Professor in Department of History in Koramangala College, University of Delhi. Without further ado, I would like to welcome sir to our studios and request him to start the lecture. Welcome sir.
Thank you. A very good afternoon to all the viewers. Today's topic of discussion is revolutionaries. The role of revolutionaries in the Indian national movement has been quite significant in the context that the way they used the cult of bomb to, in a way, provide some kind of a threat to the colonial government at that time, it was able to create some kind of fear among the British officials. And the way revolutionaries, they organized themselves from 1900 onwards, that was also very important in the context of the Indian politics, because the emergence of the Congress in 1885 and thereafter, the role of the moderates, which was played by the people, those who were part of the initial Congress, they were referred to as the moderates because they believed in the policy of prayer, protest and petition. And they were not able to exert much pressure on the colonial government, though their demands, they were quite radical in the context that they were not only covering the grievances of the local people, but they were also covering the grievances of the people, those who were not even living in India, those who were sent as indentured labor abroad. But they were not able to create that kind of impact on the colonial government. And similarly, the extremists, those who followed the moderates, though their approach was comparatively more extreme than the moderates, but even then, the British government was not taking some kind of heed to their advice or the kind of demands which were being made by the extremists. So, in the context of the failure of the policies or the politics of the moderates and the extremists, revolutionaries, they personally believed that they will be able to achieve their objective of attaining independence for India by their own radical methods, which believed in personal heroism and the cult of violence. So, if we try to locate the contribution of revolutionaries in this context, that how they were able to gain sympathy of the masses in India and how they were able to create some kind of terror or fear among the colonial government, then they were successful. But in the long run, the objective of revolutionaries to achieve independence for India could not become successful because comparatively the way they were being organized, they did not have enough resources. And at the same time, they operated in a manner of secret societies, because such kind of acts of violence were always retaliated by the government in the context of a lot of suppression and oppression. So, their techniques and their approach was comparatively quite radical, and they believed in the individual heroism of the members, that many of the members, they attacked the unpopular British officials and they wanted to eliminate those British officials, those who were oppressive for the Indian masses. And when they killed these officials, then they were able to strike some kind of a fear among the colonial government as well. At the same time, they wanted to loot the British finances so that they could finance their own activities. And for this, they engaged in a number of looting of government funds. They were in a way tired of the mendicancy of the moderate brand of politics, which was based on 3 P's, petition, prayer and protest. And at the same time, they felt that extremists failed to provide some kind of direction to the Indian freedom struggle. So what we see that the way they were following the politics of the moderates and the extremists, they believed that they will have to bring some kind of change to this brand of politics. And they were inspired by Russian nihilists, and Irish nationalists, and they believe that the kind of politics which they have to follow will be violent in nature, and they will have to organize themselves in such a way that they are able to achieve their objective of attaining some kind of free government, free rule, self-rule or independence for India. And some of the leaders, those who supported them, for example, Arvindo Ghosh, who later joined spirituality in that sense that he became some sort of a spiritual leader. But initially, he was also associated with these kind of activities, and he provided some kind of a moral strength to these revolutionaries. The way these people, they were inspired by the Russian nihilists and the Irish nationalists, was also very, very important in the context that they were also following such kind of tactics to achieve their objectives. And the way Swadeshi movement was suppressed by the colonial administration was another reason for these people to take up arms. On 27th April 1906, non-violent crowd at Barisal political conference was attacked by police without any provocation. So such kind of non-violent protests, they were being retaliated in a violent manner by the colonial government. And during the Swadeshi movement, what we see that during that movement, the way police behaved with the common masses, how police in a way violently tried to suppress such kind of a movement, also made them angry towards the role of the colonial administration, that colonial administration was not ready to provide any kind of any kind of independence to the Indian masses. And they felt that they have to take up arms in their own hands to achieve their objectives. So when we see the kind of background of this kind of movement of the revolutionaries, we see that a number of newspapers, they also played an important role, that some of the newspapers, they talked about revolutionary ideas. They were talking about that they have to use force so that they are able to achieve their objectives, because force must be stopped by force, as one of the newspapers, Jugantar, claimed in its writings. The Surat split of Congress, it also strengthened the repressive forces of colonial administration, because the way Congress was divided between the moderates and the extremists, now it weakened the Congress, and the colonial administration, it realized that it will be able to get its own way if the Congress is divided. The government launched a forceful attack on the extremist leaders, and many of the leaders, they were also arrested. For example, Arvindo Ghosh, who was arrested in Alipur conspiracy case. Bal Gangadhar Tilak was sentenced to 6 years imprisonment, and the nationalist youth, particularly in Bengal, was annoyed by the suppression of the colonial government. So what do we see? The way the government was trying to suppress youth and the other people, those who wanted to participate in the national movement, was another important indicator that how the youth or the revolutionaries, they will try to organize their activities. And they were particularly miffed with the government, with the way the government was trying to suppress their revolutionary zeal as well as the activities. They also realized that the moderate tactics, they will not be useful from that perspective, because the moderate politics of petition, prayer and protest will not be successful in the context that the British government did not believe in such kind of measures where they will in a way try to appease or try to provide some kind of relief to the Indian masses by providing them certain concessions. And they believed that they'll have to secure their own rights by their own ways. And at the same time, they felt that the extremists, they were not able to get any kind of concessions from the colonial government. And that is why a large-scale mobilization of the population also did not take place. So they realized that they have to take certain measures so that the masses, they are also mobilized for such kind of action towards their objectives. And then the kind of aims of their assassinations of the popular officials was to strike some kind of terror among the officialdom, to eliminate fear and inertia of the masses, to awaken their nationalist consciousness. So what they wanted to achieve through their objectives, by eliminating the unpopular officials, they believed that the masses, they will be awakened, they will be filled with some kind of energy that they have to sacrifice themselves for their motherland. So this was one of their important considerations when they were trying to eliminate the officials. And at the same time, they also realized that unless officials, some kind of fear will be instilled in them, then only they will be providing certain kind of concessions to the Indian population. So this kind of realization on their part that officials, they had to be in a way fearful of their activities, was another important objective as well as the activity of the revolutionaries. And to awaken the national consciousness of the masses so that masses, they are able to sacrifice themselves for their own country. So these were some of their aims. When we see that how the revolutionaries, they launched their activities in the context that Khudiram Bose and Prafull Chakki, they threw a bomb and on an unpopular judge of Muzaffarpur, they assumed that he was traveling in that carriage and they threw a bomb. And incidentally, two women, mother and daughter duo of Kennedys, they were traveling in that particular carriage. So he could not be eliminated, rather accidentally two people were killed, those who were not in any way directly related to the operation of the colonial government. So these kind of activities, when they were started, for example, this one, when we are talking about the throwing of a bomb on Kingsford. So such kind of activities initiated the kind of role which was being played by the revolutionaries. And a number of secret societies, they were also being established by them. They realized that unless they will establish certain secret societies, their objectives will not be fulfilled, because the kind of violence which they wanted to perpetrate on the British officials, the kind of activities in terms of looting of government treasuries, will not be acceptable to the colonial government. So a number of secret societies, for example, Anushilan and Yugantar, they were being opened. And in these secret societies, their aim was also to assassinate the unpopular British officials and to carry out the Swadeshi dacoities to finance their purchase of arms. And these two societies, for example, Anushilan and Yugantar, they also engaged in such kind of activities. In Madras, we see Vanchi Iyer of Bharat Masa Association killed an official who had ordered firing on masses who were agitating against police custody of leader Chidambaram Pillai. So what we see not only in Bengal, but in other parts of India, for example, in Madras, we see one of the popular leaders of Bharat Mata Association. He also got engaged in such kind of activities where they wanted to eliminate the British officials. So such kind of trend was not only limited to Bengal, but it also spread to other parts of India. And all these secret societies which were engaging in such kind of activities, they had some kind of a network by which they were trying to organize such kind of activities. For example, Anushilan Samiti, which was quite popular or active in Bengal during the Swadeshi movement. It was some sort of a volunteer corp which became quite popular during that point of time. And the way they engaged themselves in various activities was also very, very systematic. The kind of constructive work which was undertaken by them during the famines or the epidemic was quite remarkable. They also provided physical and moral training to the members, those who came to join these societies. They also propagated the meaning of Swadeshi among them. They managed the village societies, handicrafts fair and arbitration courts. They also implemented the methods of passive resistance. So what we see that these samitis, for example, Anushilan Samiti, was engaged in a number of activities which were quite diverse in nature. And the way they wanted to inculcate the ideas of Swadeshi, The way they wanted to provide all sorts of training to its members was quite unique in the context that they believed that all the training which will be provided to their members will bring some kind of a discipline in the members, and they will be able to carry out their activities in a more systematic manner. At the same time, the village handicrafts fair, the way they wanted, the way they managed these all kinds of fairs, the way they managed the village societies, how they established the various arbitration courts so that people don't have to go to the colonial courts. Rather, the popular courts will settle all the kind of disputes which they have. So these were some of the important features of these kind of societies, for example, Anushilan and the others, which became quite popular during that point of time. In Calcutta, what we see in 1902, that Pramod Mittar and Arvindo Ghosh, their emissaries from Baroda, Jatindranath Banerjee and Barindra Kumar Ghosh, they founded the Anushilan Samiti. And their activities were largely restricted to physical and moral training of the members. Calcutta Anushilan was started a newspaper called Yugantar Weekly in 1906. And they also took some abortive acts which misfired, for example, a plan to murder first Lieutenant Governor of new province of Eastern Bengal and Assam, Sir Bamfylde Fuller. So these kind of samitis, for example, Anushilan Samiti, they also initiated some kind of a constructive work in the villages, in the sense that they were providing all sorts of training to its members. And at the same time, they also undertook some kind of violent activities which were not all that successful. And such kind of abortive acts also misfired, in the sense that the government became more and more oppressive towards such kind of activities. Sumit Sarkar, he argues that Dhaka Anushilan Samiti, which was started by Pulin Das, it focused on the secret training of its members through the physical culture and the formalities of the initiation woes which were drenched in Hinduism. And during 1908-1909, due to state repression, open Samiti either vanished or converted into a radical secret society. So Sumit Sarkar, he argues that such kind of samitis which were being opened during that point of time, their focus was on some kind of physical culture. And many times their ideas or ideology was related to Hinduism, because of which some sections of the society, they felt alienated and they did not want to join such kind of societies. But what we have seen in the case of revolutionaries, that such kind of action was not deliberate, in the context that in the later part of the activities of the revolutionaries, specifically in 1920s, we find that many of the other sections of the society, especially Muslims, they also became part of the revolutionary activity. So such kind of a work which was carried on or taken up by the revolutionaries was in a way praised, because their main intention was to sacrifice themselves for the sake of the nation. So this value of sacrifice was largely applauded among the masses as well. And nowadays there is some sort of a debate also whether these revolutionaries, they should be referred as terrorists. So these revolutionaries were basically revolutionaries, and they wanted to strike some kind of a fear or terror among the colonial or the British officials. So they were not in any way terror to the Indian people. Rather, the colonial government, it tried to portray them as terrorists because they wanted to create some kind of fear among them. So the imperialist school, or the people, those who support such kind of imperialist or the colonial kind of historiography, they also refer to the revolutionaries as terrorists. But in fact, they were not terrorists in any way. Rather, when you see that their aim or objective was to free India from the colonial rule, and this they profess in their ideology, this they profess the way they are ready to sacrifice their own lives, and the kind of heroism which was displayed by them. Some kind of other activities which were carried on under the aegis of Anushilan was Hemchandra Kanungo, who went to France to acquire military and political training, which he acquired from a Russian expatriate in Paris. In the Maniktala suburb of Calcutta, a collective religious school and bomb factory was established at a garden house. Khudiram Bose and Prafulla Chaki, the way they tried to attack Kingsford, has already been discussed. So these kind of activities which were carried on by the revolutionaries was an attempt to project some kind of a approach in which they were not ready to accept the kind of politics or the policies which were being followed by the people, those who were part of the Congress or those who were engaged in the various kinds of movements, which were smaller movements, which were also trying to gain their own sectional interests as well. So revolutionaries wanted to project that kind of an image in which they were ready to sacrifice themselves. The Alipur conspiracy case was another important highlight of the activities of the revolutionaries, and because of the sheer carelessness on the part of leadership and specifically of Barinder Ghosh, the entire group had to go to jail within hours of Kennedy's murders. Prafulla Chaki shot himself dead while Khudiram Bose was tried and hanged. In this case, 34 people, they were arrested, including the Ghosh brothers. And during the court proceedings, Narendra Gosain, who had become an approver, was also murdered in prison. So what do we see? That on the sheer some kind of a carelessness on the part of one of the members, the group had to be was imprisoned by the colonial government, and one of the members who had turned an approver was also killed by, so that he is not able to provide some kind of testimony against the revolutionaries. When we also see the Anushilan Samiti, then we see the way it was systematically organized by these people, and how they also carried on the Bara dacoity on 2nd June 1908. It was another important aspect that how these people, they wanted to acquire some kind of government fund so that they can finance their activities. In the second phase, what we see is that there was some kind of an stagnation, and this kind of an stagnation was a result of regular factional and personal squabbles within the revolutionary groups, particularly Yugantar and Anushilan Samitis, where their enmity was concerned. So what we see is that wherever some kind of a personal enmity existed between these kind of societies or groups, it led to their stagnation. And the national movement also suffered in that case, that these groups could not work in unison, these groups could not work in a united manner. And if they would have worked in a united manner, then they would have been more successful in their policies or in their activities. But that was one of the weaknesses of the revolutionary movement, in the context that the way they were operating, they had to operate in a secretive way. And when these secret societies, they were operating in a secretive way, they were not able to enlist many members. And the colonial government had also employed such kind of espionage system, such kind of intelligence system, that they were able to unearth the kind of weaknesses which these kind of samitis they had. When we see the objectives of the revolutionaries, we find that in Delhi, an attempt on the life of Lord Harding was also undertaken by Raj Bihari Bose on 23rd December 1912. And the objective of revolutionaries in various parts of India was the freedom of country from the colonial rule. And they believed that Western imperialism could simply be eliminated by Western methods of violence. Therefore, they supported the cult of revolver and bomb. So, the objectives of revolutionaries, they were quite clear. They were able to realize that unless they will take up arms, unless they are able to create some kind of fear among the British officials or the colonial administration, they will not be able to achieve their objectives of freeing India from the colonial rule. Therefore, they believed in the cult of violence, as well as they wanted to use this cult of violence to in a way frighten the colonial administration. And at the same time, what we see is that these revolutionaries, they were not only operating in a very individual manner, though a limited number of revolutionaries, they directly engaged themselves in the act of heroism by directly engaging himself or herself in terms of assassination of the colonial officials. But at the same time, there was some kind of a support system which was provided to them by their own group. So what revolutionaries do basically is that they establish a number of secret societies. They recruit youth in these secret societies because youth were comparatively more inspirational, they had more energy and they had more zing to sacrifice their lives in a violent manner for their own country. They inculcated in them notions of self-sacrifice for the sake of country. At the same time, they taught their members use of arms and manufacture of bomb. They realized that unless members will be trained in the manufacture of bombs or how to use the firearms, the members will not be successful. So therefore, secretively, they operated at different levels. They in certain portions of certain cities, they rented out certain places on which they established some kind of a small factories or a small households where revolutionaries, they got together, and some of the young revolutionaries, those who have joined their groups, they were being taught how to use the firearms as well as how to make bombs. So such kind of activities on the part of revolutionaries was very understandable in the sense that colonial administration will not allow them to acquire sophisticated kinds of firearms. So it was imperative on their part that they organize themselves and they create such kind of conditions where they are able to procure some kind of firearms for themselves. When we see the role of Chapekar brothers, we find that the first political assassination of the Europeans was undertaken by them. Balkrishna and Damodar, they were the two brothers, on 22nd June 1897 at Pune. These people, they undertook this political assassination, and Mr. Rand, who was the president of the plague committee at Pune, was the object of their assassination, but Lieutenant Aist was killed. And the aggravation was that plague committee was sending troops to the check houses of the civilians for plague afflicted people. So this was not liked by Chapekar brothers, that it was some kind of interference in their private lives and some kind of oppression was being used. Another important figure was V.D. Savarkar. He started Mitra Mela in 1904, and his brother Ganesh formed, both of them, they collectively formed Mitra Mela, which later merged into a secret society called Abhinav Bharat. So V.D. Savarkar's role was also very important in the context that he began his journey from here, and thereafter he was also instrumental in going to India House in Britain or London, which was established by one of the important revolutionaries. And this revolutionary also played an important role, Shamaji Krishna Verma, who formed the India House in London. And a general called the Indian Sociologist was also published from there. And a number of activities were carried out by the members there. Madan Lal Dhingra, for example, V.D. Savarkar, etc. They became quite instrumental here, where Madan Lal Dhingra killed Karzan Wali. So this was one of the members who was political ADC to the India office, William Wiley. William Wiley, who was the political ADC to the India office. So this was being done in the context that all these revolutionaries, they were taking part in such kind of activities. They wanted to inspire the younger generation so that they take up arms for the cause of freedom. So I'd like to end the discussion here. Thank you so much. We'll be right back. Very good afternoon to all the viewers. Today's topic of discussion is revolutionaries. As we all know, the contribution of revolutionaries to the Indian national movement was immense. The way they came to the Indian forefront in the context that how the moderate and the extremist brand of politics was not acceptable to them, in the context that they realized that they were not able to achieve the kind of objectives for the freedom of India. So they decided that they should take to the cult of violence, and they individually bore arms and killed the unpopular British officials. At the same time, they undertook a number of dacoities so that they are able to finance their firearms. So such were the kind of methods which were being employed by the revolutionaries in India. And not only these revolutionaries were working in India, but at the same time a number of revolutionaries, they went abroad. And when they were there, for example, in London, Shyamaji Krishna Verma, who started the India House, and Ajit Singh, who was the uncle of Bhagat Singh, and Madam Bhikhaji Kama. So these were the important leaders, those who were contributing from abroad. They were trying to bring some kind of a public opinion in other countries so that they also provide some kind of a support to the Indian national movement. Apart from that, there was another important movement which became quite popular at that point of time, which was known as the Gadar movement or the Gadar party. The movement was very important in the context that its origins were not in India, rather its origins were elsewhere. It began its journey from America, and thereafter the objective of this movement was to, in a way, awaken the Indian masses, and they believed that if Indian masses, they will be awakened, then they will be able to achieve their objective of freedom. And for this, a number of activities, a number of efforts were made by a number of leaders, those who were associated with the Gadar party. Gadar in Urdu or Punjabi, it means revolt or rebellion. And this movement also aimed in a way to rebel against the colonial government. And these people, those who were part of this Gadar movement, were the Punjabi immigrants who had settled in North America. And the kind of racial discrimination against them, it led to realization that their enslaved position in relation to British in India was main cause of their status in USA. They decided to organize themselves so that their status could be improved and to free India from colonial crutches of an exploited and exploitative and racial British government. So what we see is that these Punjabi immigrants, those who had traveled to North America, they realized that if they wanted to improve their status in America in any way, because in America they were considered to be the citizens of a country which was being enslaved by British. So they had to improve their condition in America. It was imperative that their condition in India itself should also improve. And to improve their condition, it was very necessary that they should achieve independence from the colonial rule. So they established some kind of a party or an association from in America, and America they operated a number of leaders like Lala Hardayal, etc. They became Sohan Singh Bhakna. They became quite popular, and they tried to organize Indians not only in America but in other parts of the world, so that all of them, they marched towards India in some way, they decided it. And thereafter, they are able to achieve the objective of freeing India from the colonial rule. So what Gadarites, they realized was that there was a need for a central organization, and an effective leader was also realized. And Lala Hardayal, he joined their cause. He was a political exile from India. And in May 1913, they established Hindi Association in Portland, which was renamed as Hindustan Gadar Party. At the first meeting of association, Sohan Singh Bhakna was elected president, Lala Hardayal general secretary, and Pandit Kashiram Maroli as treasurer. Decisions were taken to establish a headquarter by name of Yugantar Ashram and start a newspaper, Gadar, for free circulation. So what happened when this kind of an association was formed by the people, those who had migrated to America from India, they realized that unless they will improve their condition in India, their condition in America will not improve. And Lala Hardayal was able to devote a lot of time to the activities of the Gadar Party. When he joined them, Sohan Singh Bhakna joined them. Then some kind of a concerted effort was made by these people so that some kind of a revolution could be brought about in India. And they also started a newspaper, and they believed that when such a newspaper will be started, then their ideas or ideology will be spread in India and in other parts of the world. And influenced by their ideology, a number of people will also join their movement. So the weekly, the title which was titled as the Gadar, was started from San Francisco on November 1st, 1913. And it was done in the commemoration of the revolt of 1857. So Gadarites, they believed that revolt was an important source of an inspiration. And revolt, though revolt became unsuccessful in the context that it did not provide independence to India, but even then, the way people participated in the revolt of 1857 was quite remarkable. And when they started this weekly, the language which was being used by these people was also very awakening, or so in a way radical in nature. The first issue of the newspaper, it declared, "Today there begins Gadar in foreign lands, but in our country's tongue, a war against the British Raj. What is our name? Gadar. What is our work? Gadar. Where will be the revolution? In India. The time will soon come when rifles and blood will take the place of pens and ink." The Gadar, which carried the slogan on masthead of the newspaper, "Angrezi Raj Ka Dushman," declared, "Wanted brave soldiers to stir up rebellion in India. Pay death, price martyrdom, pension liberty, field of battle India." So the kind of language which was being used by the Gadarites in their newspapers was itself quite radical in the nature that it wanted youth to join their movement and sacrifice themselves for the sake of the country. And they believed that the colonial government will not provide any kind of concessions to the Indians, and in every way colonial government was quite suppressive and oppressive in nature, and unless Indians, they will decide to liberate themselves from the colonial crutches, India will not be liberated in any manner. So this kind of an idea was quite unique in the sense. At the same time, their ideology was very secular in nature. They did not have any kind of communal affinities or communal ideas in their ideology. They were highly patriotic in nature. They had deep sense of love for their own country, and they wanted to liberate India from the colonial and oppressive foreign rule. They set up some kind of an organization called Yugantar Ashram, and their objective was to instill some kind of patriotic ideas in the masses, so that the masses, they feel patriotic towards their own country and are ready to sacrifice themselves for the sake of the country. And the front page of the newspaper always carried the title that "Angrezi Raj Ka Kaccha Chitta," on an expose of the British rule. So in this way, they wanted to expose the kind of works which had been undertaken by the colonial government. They realized that unless the activities of the British will be exposed to the Indian population or the population in other parts of the world, they will not realize that the kind of harm which the British government was doing towards their own country. So they wanted to, in a way, expose the colonial government in the sense that all the kinds of activities which were quite, disadvantageous to the Indians will be exposed, and at the same time these kind of activities will also be known to the masses, not only in India but abroad as well, especially in other parts of the world where a number of revolutionaries they had also gone. And these revolutionaries will at the same time mobilize the masses in other parts of the world in a way to financially support the movement, or physically support the movement by going to India. So these were some of the important objectives or the considerations of the Gadarites when they wanted to undertake this kind of a project. They also started an Indian Independence Committee. What we see is with the outbreak of the First World War in 1914, Lala Hardayal and others, they went to Germany and they established the Indian Independence Committee. The committee planned to send volunteers, as you can see on the screen as well. To India to incite rebellion among the armed forces, to provide explosives to Indian revolutionaries, to invade British India, to secure independence from colonial rule. So what we see is that the aim of the Indian Independence Committee was also such that a number of volunteers, they should be sent to India so they are able to incite some kind of rebellion among the masses. And when they will be able to incite the rebellion among the masses, and this rebellion will also be armed, then they will be able to, in a way, throw the British out of India. At the same time, they wanted that some kind of explosives to the Indian revolutionaries, they should also be provided, some kind of help from their revolutionaries, those who were working in other parts of India, in other parts of the world, they will send some kind of arms and ammunitions to their Indian counterparts in a way strengthen the movement which was being launched by the Indian revolutionaries. And they wanted that the British India should in a way be invaded by the volunteers from across the world. And when these volunteers, they will go to India, then they will in a way force the colonial government to go out of India. There was another important issue which was also related with the Gadar movement, which was the Koma Gata Maru case. In this case, what happened was that in Punjab, there was some kind of an explosive circumstances which were there. And a ship was chartered, and the Canadian immigration laws, which forbade the admission to everyone, excluding those who made a direct passage in their own ship. A contractor called Gurdeep Singh, he chartered a Japanese ship, Koma Gata Maru, and with nearly 400 Indians, he sailed for Vancouver. Canadian authorities refused permission to land and ship sailed back to Calcutta. Indians felt that British had incited Canadian authorities. The aggressive approach of British resulted in a fight on arrival of ship in Calcutta, in which several inmates of ship died. So what we see is that Koma Gata Maru incident, in which a number of Indians, they went to Canada, and how they were being turned away, and when they came back to Calcutta, how there was a fight between the colonial administration and the inmates of the ship, in which a number of casualties they took place. So this incident was also associated with the movement during the time when the movement was launched. When we try to assess kind of contribution which was made by the Gadarites, that it was able to popularize the nationalist ideology, and particularly against the colonialism, and it generated understanding among the huge masses in India and overseas that Indian poverty and backwardness was as a result of the colonial rule. So this kind of an approach could be seen, where they were able to inspire the masses. Then when we see that the kind of ideology of Gadar was quite egalitarian in nature. They did not want to create any kind of distinctions, and their ideology had all the kinds of democratic content in it. They had a strongly secular viewpoint. Sohan Singh Bhakna, he stated, "We are not Sikhs or Punjabis. Our religion is patriotism." So we can very well understand the ideology of the Gadar from this statement, because the kind of statement which had been made by Sohan Singh Bhakna, that their religion was patriotism. So they're not there to profess any kind of regionalism. They were not there to profess any kind of sectarian approach. Rather, their approach was all encompassing, because they were claiming that patriotism was the only religion which was in a way they wanted or desired for themselves. And at the same time, they were more democratic in their approach. They were more egalitarian in their approach, in the sense that they did not want to create any kind of distinctions within the movement itself. When we try to assess the weaknesses of the Ghadar movement, we will find that they overrated the level of readiness of the movement. People were not all that ready for the movement, and they overrated it. They were misplaced in their thinking that huge population in India was ready and prepared to take on British. They underestimated the power of the colonial rulers. Their conviction that all that the people of India needed was a call to revolt was an added weakness of the movement. So when we try to assess the movement on the basis of its weaknesses, we will realize that they had this kind of a misplaced thinking that Indians in India were ready for the movement, and ready in the sense that not only mentally but physically as well. So that was not the case, in the context that Indians were not ready for any such kind of an armed revolt where they have to fight against the British, and British were better prepared than the Indians, and mentally also Indians were not in a way prepared for such kind of a revolutionary action at that point of time. On the other hand, they in a way underestimated the role the British could play in terms of suppressing this activity. They felt that the colonials were not all that strong in India. Rather, opposite was true in the case of India, because the colonial government exerted a lot of authority and power in India. How the way they organized the army in India, the way they held their sway over the police forces was in a way some kind of detrimental to the interests of the Indians. So this was another kind of an assumption of the Ghadarites, that Indians were in a way prepared and British were not all that, rather they underestimated the strength of the British. So that was one of the reason or one of the weaknesses of the movement. When we try to see the decline of the movement, we will find that the state repression was quite an important factor in the framework of the decline of the Ghadar movement. And the draconian laws of the government, the way government had imposed various laws on the people, was another important factor. And the lack of popular support was another important factor in this phase of the revolutionary activity. So Ghadar was an important phase in the Indian freedom movement, not only in the revolutionary activity, rather in the entire Indian national movement. When we try to place the contribution of Ghadarites, it was quite immense, because they were not only asking people in India to oppose Indians, rather they were also asking Indians, those who were there in every part of the world, to come together, to unite against the colonial government, and to provide all sorts of support to the people, those who were there in India. So that was an important contribution of the Ghadar movement. When we try to see the second phase of the revolutionary activity in India, we see that some kind of a disappointment which was caused by the non-cooperation movement, with the withdrawal of the non-cooperation movement. When we see, because of the Chauri Chaura incident, the movement was withdrawn, and the political situation led to the revival of the revolutionary activity. And these revolutionaries in northern India, two broad strands of revolutionary activities they developed after 1922, one in Punjab, Bihar, UP in central province, and other in Bengal. Both of them were influenced by new social and ideological forces, and they led to growth of socialist ideas and groups and development of a militant trade union movement. So what we see is that in the second phase of the revolutionary movement, especially in 1920s, when the non-cooperation movement was withdrawn. So after that, a new surge of revolutionary activity could be seen during this particular movement, not only in Bengal, but in other parts of India. and some of the ideas which came to the forefront during that point of time, which were related to the socialist ideals, and at the same time some sort of a militant trade union movement was also visible at this point of time in the revolutionary movement. Hindustan Republican Association was another important organization which was formed during this point of time, and they believed that an all India organization should be created so that the revolutionary activity at different levels or in different regions of India could be organized in a much better way, and revolutionaries are able to help each other when they were carrying out such kind of activities against the government. So some kind of an efforts were also being made so that such kind of associations could also be formed. And in Kanpur, basically in October 1924, a meeting of revolutionaries took place, and Hindustan Republican Association, which was later reorganized as Hindustan Socialist Republican Association or Army, HSRA, was also established. HRA organized Kakori conspiracy, Kakori robbery, and many revolutionaries were tried in Kakori conspiracy case. So what we see is that a number of revolutionaries, they came together, and Kakori conspiracy case in which the people, those who were engaged in the Kakori robbery, they were being tried in this particular case. And in 1928, what happened was that Lala Lajpat Rai, he got hurt during one of the demonstrations, and when this kind of a blow was hurled on Lala Lajpat Rai, which was taking place against the anti-Simon Commission processions in Lahore, and the revolutionaries, he also succumbed to his injuries, he died, and when he died, the revolutionaries, they felt that his death should, or his murder in a way, should be avenged. And Bhagat Singh, Rajguru and Sukhdev, they killed Saunders, a police official who was involved in the lathi charge on Lala Lajpat Rai. So this was an important phase in the revolutionary activity which was taking place in India. And the avenging of Lala Lajpat Rai, where a number of groups, they became quite active, and these revolutionaries later also became more popular when they threw bomb on the assembly, and their objective was to get caught. They did not want to run away, as later acknowledged by Bhagat Singh, who said that they wanted that the deaf ears of the government should listen to them, and that is why they threw a bomb, and they deliberately stayed back so that they should be caught, and they are able to propagate their ideology to the masses. So when they threw this kind of a bomb on the Central Legislative Assembly on 8th April 1929, and to make the deaf hear, so that was an important phase in the context that when in the trials these leaders or these revolutionaries, they were being produced in the court, they were suggesting that they wanted to deliberately harm the colonial government. They deliberately wanted their countrymen to realize that how the British government was trying to throttle the aspirations of Indians in every way. And these people, they were in a way charged, or they were tried in the Lahore conspiracy case by the British government. And when they were being tried, at one point of time it was being suggested that the popularity of Bhagat Singh was such that he became more popular than Mahatma Gandhi, even. It was reported by some of the newspapers. So Bhagat Singh became quite popular at that point of time, and a number of films later were also made on the life of Bhagat Singh, which also became quite popular. In the context of the prison conditions in which the revolutionaries lived, what we see is that Jatin Das was a young revolutionary, and he started a fast that they should be tried as political prisoners, that some sort of a status of political prisoners should be given to these revolutionaries. And many of the revolutionaries, they were being convicted and sent to cellular jail in Andaman. And when they were sent to Andamans, the way they lived their life, the kind of cells, very small cells in the Andaman jails where these revolutionaries used to live. And Bhagat Singh, Rajguru and Sukhdev, they were hanged on 23rd March 1931. So, with the hanging of Rajguru, Bhagat Singh and Sukhdev, another important phase begins in the Indian National Movement in the context that a large number of people, they came against the government, because the way they were being tried, the way they were being treated in the jail, the way they were being hanged by the government was not liked by the masses of India. So when we see the ideological orientations of HRA and HSRA, we see that their program was quite secular in nature. And the democratic and socialist aspirations could be seen in their programs. And fundamental principle of republic was to attain universal suffrage and the abolition of all systems which make any kind of exploitation of men by men possible. Bhagat Singh had already, before his arrest in 1929, discarded his belief in individual act of heroism. And he became convinced that revolution meant arousing population and organizing a mass movement. So Bhagat Singh had also realized that individual heroism will not be able to achieve the objective of independence. So he, in his writings, he realizes that the path of individual heroism had to be abandoned so that India is able to achieve its independence. He was also a believer in the socialist principles, where he did not believe that any kind of exploitation of man by man should take place. Rather, he believed in the egalitarian aspects, that no nation or no man should be exploited. Bhagat Singh defined socialism as leading to abolition of capitalism and class domination. So Bhagat Singh, he believed that abolition of capitalism should take place and class domination should also not be there. So any distinctions which were there on the basis of classes should be done away with. And at the same time, he realized that capitalism was a threat, and this threat will not be able to bring out the principles of socialism in India. Another important group which I would like to talk about was Suri Sen's Chittagong group. And this group gained quite recognition at that point of time. A number of films were also made. A Bengali film was made on this activity of this group. Surya Sen was the important leader of this group. In Hindi also, two films were made, Khele Hum Ji Jaan Se by Ashutosh Govarikar, and another film, Chittagong, in which Manoj Vajpayee played the role of Surya Sen. This was also made. So what we see is that Chittagong group was instrumental in the armory case, and the armory raid by Surya Sen was quite significant activity of this particular group. And the way they tried to organize themselves was also very, very important in the context that they committed this kind of a daring act on 18th April 1930. What we see is that the role of revolutionaries in Indian National Movement was quite instrumental in the context that revolutionaries were also those people, those who were coming from the common masses, and they realized that unless they will carry on their activities in such way, they will not be able to achieve their independence. So with this, I'd like to conclude the discussion. Thank you so much.
On that note, I would like to thank sir for this very interesting discussion, and thank you dear friends for watching our show. Stay tuned and keep watching. Thank you.